சப்ஸ்கிரைப் மை சேனல். பி சரளா. Hit the bell icon so that you are notified every time I post a new lesson.
Sure. What are these people are doing? Yeah, they are exercising. So, in exercise, coordination of the body is very important. So, which organ system is useful for coordination? Yes, this is the brain, the neural system. So, neural system is useful for the coordination of the body organs. So, our body is coordinated by two systems, neural system and the endocrine system. Today, we are going to learn about the human neural system. Human neural system is divided into two types, central neural system and the peripheral neural system. Central neural system consists of a brain and the spinal cord. See, these two are the important structures in the central neural system. Peripheral neural system consists of the nerves arising from the brain, which are known as cranial nerves, and nerves arising from the spinal cord, which are known as spinal nerves. So, first we learn about the structure of brain. So, this is the development of the brain in the womb. It contains three vesicles. The neural tube contains three vesicles, the prosencephalon, mesencephalon and the rhombencephalon. So, these three vesicles give stress the different parts of the brain. So, prosencephalon forms into forebrain, mesencephalon forms midbrain and rhombencephalon forms the hindbrain. That's why prosencephalon is divided into two regions, telencephalon and diencephalon. Telencephalon gives rise to the cerebrum and diencephalon gives rise to the thalamus, hypothalamus and the epithalamus parts of the forebrain. So, midbrain, mesencephalon gives only the midbrain. Midbrain consists of two parts, the crura cerebri and the colliculi. So, the rhombencephalon is divided into two regions, metencephalon and myelencephalon. So, metencephalon gives rise pons veroli and the cerebellum, myelencephalon gives medulla oblongata. So, the growth of the prosencephalon is very drastic, that's why the size of the prosencephalon or the forebrain is larger than these two remaining parts. Okay, 80% of the brain consists of the forebrain, remaining 20% midbrain and hindbrain. So, next, this is the adult brain. So, this brain is protected in a bony structure which is known as a skull. So, in the skull or the cranium, brain is protected. Okay. So, it is surrounded by three membranes. So, the membranes which surrounding the brain are known as meninges. So, the outermost membrane is known as dura mater, which is a tough and double layered structure. So, it is the lining of the cranial cavity. So, here cranium is present, skull or the cranium is present. So, it is lining of the cranial cavity. Next membrane, the middle membrane is known as arachnoid matter. So, it is a thin webby structure. So, the space between the dura mater and the arachnoid matter is known as subdural space. So, the innermost membrane is known as pia mater. So, it is very close to the brain. So, this is a thin and highly vascular structure. Vascular means it is richly supplied with the blood capillaries because it has to nourish the brain. So, through the blood oxygen and nutrients are supplied to the brain. Okay. So, the space between arachnoid matter and pia mater. So, this is the space. This is known as subarachnoid space and it is filled with cerebrospinal fluid. Cerebrospinal fluid is very important to protect the brain from the jerks and sudden shocks during the trauma. So, this is about the overall view of the brain. So, this is the forebrain. So, this is the brain stem. Midbrain and the hindbrain forms the brain stem. Forebrain structures. Brain consists of three parts, olfactory lobes, cerebrum and diencephalon. So, this is the
cerebrum.
Here olfactory lobes are present. So, this is the location where the olfactory bulbs are present. So, these are the cerebral hemispheres. So cerebrum is divided into two equal halves by a longitudinal fissure. This is the longitudinal fissure, divides the cerebrum into two equal halves, right and the left cerebral hemispheres. Okay, right cerebral hemisphere controls the left side of the body and the left cerebral hemisphere controls the right side of the body. So you have to remember the cross. So you have to remember the cross. So if you remember the cross, so the left hemisphere controls the right side of the body and the right one controls the left side of the body. So this is the outer surface of the cerebrum. So cerebrum is the largest part of the brain. So it occupies about 80% of the brain. So the outer surface of the cerebrum is known as cerebral cortex. So this is the cerebral cortex. So this cerebral cortex consists numerous folds or convolutions. These folds are known as gyri. Singular is gyrus, plural is gyri. So these are the furrows. So furrows are two types, shallower furrows and the deep furrows. Shallow, these are all the shallow furrows, grooves. These are known as sulci. So the deeper grooves are known as fissures. So in examination they may ask, what are the shallower grooves? Shallower grooves are nothing but the sulci and the deeper grooves are nothing but the fissures. So longitudinal fissure, so these are the transverse fissures. So these fissures divide the cerebral hemisphere, each cerebral hemispheres into four lobes. So frontal lobe, which is present below the frontal bone of the skull, and parietal lobe, occipital lobe and the temporal lobe. Temporal lobe lies above the ear region. So these four lobes, the surface of these four lobes consists of two types of cortex. So primary cortex and the associated cortex. Primary cortex is mainly related with the sensory and motor functions, and associated cortex is involved in the integration and processing of the primary cortex functions, that is sensory and motor. The processing occurs in the associated area. So that's why the brain is known as a CPU of the computer. CPU means central processing unit in a computer. That's why the human brain is compared with the computer. Okay. So next, the frontal lobe is mainly concerned with the execution. So it is a boss of our body. So it is responsible for each and every action of our body. So it contains a structure. Here this area is known as motor area, and from this area motor nerves arise and they goes to the different effective organs. So next, this is the parietal lobe. Parietal lobe is mainly concerned with the somatosensory function. So all the sensory nerves from the different parts of our body, sense organs, comes to the parietal lobe, and here the processing occurs, and through the motor area the signals are sent to the effective organs. So this lobe is occipital lobe. This occipital lobe is useful for the vision. So next, the temporal lobe. Temporal lobe is mainly concerned with the hearing. So the sense of hearing is in the temporal lobe, and this lobe is mainly concerned with the learning of language. So we learn the language only by hearing and observing our surroundings. So and we associated those things with our occipital lobe. So here vision. So that's why the memory and language skills are developed in the temporal lobe. So this is about the, and also memory and intelligence are also associated with the temporal lobe. So this is about the cerebral cortex and the four lobes. Next, we will move to the medulla region of the cerebrum. So the inner region of the cerebrum is known as medulla of the cerebrum. So in the medulla, deeper, contains lobes which are known as hippocampal lobes and the amygdala are present. So hippocampal lobes are mainly concerned with the memory. So they convert the short term memory into long term memory, and amygdala is mainly for the emotions like happiness, anxiety, cry, laughter, all these are associated with the amygdala and the thalamus. So the next part of the forebrain is the thalamus part of the brain. So the thalamus and hypothalamus, amygdala and hippocampal, these four structures form a limbic system of the brain, and this is associated with the emotional and the sexual behavior of a person. So this is very, very important. Limbic system controls all our emotions and sexual behavior. So there is a trick to remember the limbic system lobes. So H for hat. H means hippocampus, another H means hypothalamus, A means amygdala, T means thalamus. If you remember H for hat, then you easily remember the limbic system of the brain. So this limbic system is mainly concerned with the emotional and the sexual behavior of a person. Okay, next. So in the medulla of the cerebral hemispheres, there is a band of nervous tissue, a transverse band of nervous tissue is present, which connects the right and left cerebral hemispheres, and this is known as corpus callosum. Corpus callosum is very, very important because it is present only in the mammal's brain. It is absent in all other phyla. Okay. So this is one of the characteristic features of the mammalian brains. So next, diencephalon. So diencephalon is also known as thalamencephalon. So it consists of three parts: epithalamus, thalamus, and hypothalamus. Thalamus means inner room. So it is oval in shape. So the roof of the thalamus is known as epithalamus. It is a non-nervous tissue, and it is in close contact with the biometer and forms the anterior choroid plexus. The epithelium of the epithalamus forms a stalk, which is known as a pineal stalk. At the end of the pineal stalk, a round structure is present, which is known as a pineal body. So this is the thalamus. Thalamus is mainly concerned with the motor and the sensory signaling. So this is the coordinating, central coordinating part of the motor and sensory signaling. Below the thalamus, hypothalamus is present. So hypothalamus is continued as a funnel shaped structure, which is known as infundibulum, and this connects the pituitary gland to the hypothalamus. This hypothalamus region contains a groups of neurosecretory cells, and they secrete the hormones. That's why these hormones are known as hypothalamic hormones. Hypothalamus is mainly useful for the control of osmolarity, thermoregulatory in function. It controls the thirst, hunger, and also sexual behavior, as it is a part of the limbic system. It also controls the emotional and the sexual behavior of the person. So this is about the diencephalon. So these three parts comes under the forebrain of the our brain system. So the outer surface, the cerebral hemisphere, is gray in color due to the presence of the cell bodies of all the neurons. That's why this is known as a gray matter. So here the corpus callosum, or the inner part of the forebrain, is white in color because all the myelinated axons are concentrated in this region. Okay, so the outer region of the brain is gray in color, and it consists of a gray matter, and the inner is white in color. It is known as white matter. It is formed by the myelinated axons of all the neurons present in the forebrain. So this is about the forebrain of the human being. In the next class, we study about the other parts of the brain.